Welcome back to Turning Hard Times into Good Times. I'm your host, Jay Taylor, and I'm really glad to have with me once again Jim Payne. He's the president and CEO of DynaCert, Inc. That's a company, Canadian company that appears to be making some really good progress in generating sales from its hydrogen carbon emissions reduction technology. DynaCert trades in Toronto under the symbol DYA. You can buy it down here in the U.S. as I have under the symbol DYFSF. 230.7 million shares outstanding at last count. At least that's what I've seen. $1.05 yesterday, at least in Canadian money, 72 cents in U.S. money, somewhere around that range, giving it a market cap of 240 million Canadian or 166 million roughly speaking, in U.S. dollars. The stock has done very, very well. It's a very constructive-looking chart. So I'm really pleased to have Jim with me. Thanks for joining me again, Jim.
Thank you, Jay. It's always a pleasure.
Yeah, always fun to talk to you, especially it's fun to talk to companies that are on the upswing. And, you know, you were last on my show back on March 21st, and shortly before that, in February, you had just announced your first sales orders of $1.8 million. Now I see on March more recently, you've announced a $2.7 million in sales at Canadian money. Just for the sake of listeners who may not be familiar with DynaCert, can you tell them, can you explain what your hydrogen technology is all about and what applications it is meant for?
Absolutely. I mean, our current unit, our hydrogen, or HG1, it is a very unique patent-pending unit. It's a demand It's a demand electrolysis unit. It's designed for internal combustion engines. What we do is we supply the air intake with hydrogen and oxygen gases. We separate it. The results in that, you know, shows increased fuel economy, increased torque, extended engine oil life, and the reduction in emissions. And as you know, we have not that long ago got verification of our fuel savings on an average of 19.2%. The greenhouse gases, we're reducing that on an average of 40%, and a particulate matter in 65%.
Mm. Yeah, that's pretty impressive. Now, Jim, before we went on the air, you were talking about your HG2 technology. What does that do that the HG1 doesn't do? What's that all about?
Well, our HG2, that's just about a month or month and a half ago, we had our AGM, and at that point, we introduced our HG2. It's a unit that is about a quarter the size of our original unit, and this is being developed for the reefer market, which is refrigeration units. I never understood before, but that market is actually 3.5 times greater than the trucking industry in North America.
Wow.
But, they have smaller engines, but this unit will also, so this unit is being designed specifically for that and for class 6 and 7 trucks, or the average delivery trucks, and or buses. And so we've developed it, our engineers developed this thing. It's really cool to see. But it so we are just actually receiving this week our first final prototype, and we've got one of Loblaw's reefers that they had donated to us or lent to us for the development of this parked out front, and we were very anxious to get the thing on there to start measuring the performance on it.
Yeah, for Americans that may not be familiar, Loblaw's is a very large grocery retailer, is that it,
grocery
in Canada?
Retail, that's correct, yeah.
Uh-huh, and they must have a lot of trucks, and if this can work, they might be a customer of yours.
They've got a lot of trucks, and they've got a lot of refrigeration units. But, yeah, they have actually, you know, they've actually got units on their transport trucks right now. They're doing a very controlled test of this. They purchased the first 4 units to try them out, and you know, they are very excited about what's happening there. And so on the heels of that, they brought over one of these reefers and introduced us to this market and actually lent us a reefer unit here, and it, you know, told us if we need it for 6 months for the development. They said, you know, we want to be the first in the market to be able to boldly talk about this. So we're excited about it.
Jim, you mentioned before we went on the air that there's you're talking expansion again, possibly at least. Is that for the HG2 unit, or can you talk about that at all?
Yeah, well, as you know, it wasn't long ago we just expanded, you know, into another 8,000 square feet of manufacturing, but we're just finalized the deal, and within the next 6 weeks, we're doubling the size of it again. And so this is for two things. Number one, our HG1 units for trucks, and we're producing right now on an average of 50 units a day and shipping them all over the place, and we're increasing that very rapidly. But then with this HG2, this is certainly a market that that we're very aggressively going after too.
So the HG2 will be produced in one plant or a different section of the same plant or what?
It'll be in a different section of the same plant.
I see. Okay. All right. Well, your first application has been this HG1, the retrofit of the trucks, commercial larger trucks. So how are the sales going there? Pretty well from what I can tell, but can you give us some insight into the sales for the HG1?
Yeah, the sales are going very well. Our financials just went out last night for our year end, and it's actually shows us now as a totally debt-free company, and today we just announced the retirement of the final debts of the company. But as far as sales, you know, we have announced just under $5 million in sales to date. We just started sales, I don't know, what is it, 6 weeks ago or so? And so our first quarter, we doubled our expectation there. Our second quarter, we've already half-filled what our expectations were. And as things ramp up, I mean, you know, our expectations are we're going to do $108 million in sales this year.
Oh, that's and you talked in the past about margins. Are they, maybe it's too early to know yet, but are they holding up pretty well? Because they were pretty robust margins.
Jay, the margins are crazy, and they are holding up. And actually, our first quarter financials will be going out in the next couple of weeks. And at that point, it'll clearly define what those are. And everybody we're talking to on Bay Street and on the market right now are just floored by what the margins are, but and certainly as we continue to expand and continue to manufacture more, the margins will actually even get better than they were in the past. So,
you have a Canadian government up there that is very friendly towards what you're doing, an environmentally friendly administration up there, a government, a national government that's very pro green, you might say. Maybe in somewhat in contrast to our new president down here, and you've also recently had a friendly reception from Europe, where they're also quite concerned about the environment. How is politics playing into your game plans? I would think quite favorable in Canada and Europe, but can you talk about some regulation that's been passed? I think that recognizes your technology in Europe.
Well, in Europe, yes, we just received our CE certification in Europe, so our technology is now certified for Europe. We have not long ago hired a new VP of global sales. We actually imported him from Europe. I mean, this is a gentleman with 30-plus years experience in logistics, but also in sales, and so he's been here for the last few weeks. He is actually traveling back to Europe next week to spend a couple of weeks there. He's already got a huge interest in Europe, and we're shipping some units over there next week for him. But also, you know, here our Canadian government is, I would dare say, they're now calling us their poster child. And, you know, we have certainly, you know, they've made very bold statements of what they're going to do as far as reducing greenhouse gases and cleaning the environment. And I dare to say that DynaCert is playing a very big role in that to help them achieve that.
Well, you've also, I mean, if you've got carbon credits and that sort of legislation, has that been passed? Is there something like that in Canada now, a market for carbon credits?
Well, they just started the cap and trade. I mean, they're still trying to figure this thing out, but the carbon credits are definitely becoming a reality, and that's one thing. You know, I have said, anybody knows me, I've said for years that, you know, this company is going to get to the point where our product will be worth its weight in gold just in carbon credits. And I believe that's really becoming a reality, because with our smart ECU, which is the brain behind our technology, and that I would certainly say is our most valued asset. I mean, but our smart ECU, I mean, it's like a smartphone. It's learning all the time. It communicates with the onboard computer of an engine. So it's altering the flow of gases, and it's learning how to get the maximum benefit or burn out of the engine, but it is also, you know, tracking and monitoring fuel savings, emission savings, and then converting it to carbon credits. So, and this is new technology that we hold. It's patent pending. We got worldwide patent pending on it. And then David Bridge, you know, the gentleman that we brought on, you know, that is the brains behind our brain, you know, he originally came on as a consultant, then he became so ingrained with the company, we gave him the title of COO. Now, just as of officially this morning, we announced, I mean, he has stepped down from the role of COO so that he can be 110% focused on the development and further development of our Smart ECU, because this thing is, you know, an ongoing thing, and he's also very, very extremely good at patents. So, you know, to increase our holdings and our patents, you know, he is going to focus on that. And then we have brought new, very seasoned engineer with years of experience in manufacturing that has taken on the role of COO that we just announced this morning.
Yes, indeed. And what I wonder about, though, you know, you have this carbon credit thing, but also you talk about a 19.2% saving in fuel. And so whether you're orientated towards environmental health or not, 19.2% savings for truck companies would be very meaningful, I would think.
You're absolutely right. I mean, it's certainly the number one largest fixed cost in the trucking industry is the fuel, and you know, 19.2%. And I can tell you that, you know, we've got units being installed every day. We have several units out there. The units are meeting and exceeding our expectations as far as fuel savings and emission savings. So, you know, but even at 10% fuel savings, their return on investment is less than 1 year. Typical long transport hauler, their return on investment at 10% fuel savings is 8 months. So it becomes a no-brainer.
Yeah. And I guess the efficiency with this smart ECU or the technology that you have, as you explained to me the last time you were on, there's a difference depending on the environment these trucks are operating on that the burn has to be somewhat different or adjustments can be made. Is that right, on an ongoing basis so that optimization is reached with this technology?
No, you're absolutely right. And that's what I was saying. You know, there's so many variables and there's so many changes all the time, from anything from environment to climate to altitude to humidity, and it just goes on and on and on. Well, with our smart ECU and the way it's learning and understanding this, it does alter the flows so that, you know, we are, you know, working towards maximizing the burn at any given time.
Jim, with just less than 2 minutes left, actually about a minute left now, can you? I see that the company's, your shares were accepted in the TSX Venture 50. What is that? Has that given you a boost? I suppose with respect to investment funds and so forth that would be investing in you.
Well, I definitely think that gave us a boost. It's certainly. Because we weren't just recognized as the top 50, we were actually recognized as the number one top company in science and innovation for the last year, and the number one top stock performing company for the last year. So, you know, we actually got special recognition for that. And then, you know, as the company is moving forward and continuing to move forward, we are already in the process of taking the company from the Venture Exchange onto the Toronto Exchange, and so we're going to start playing with the big boys.
Yeah, well, indeed you should, and I suppose as those numbers keep climbing. Just 30 seconds. Anything else you'd like to add before we conclude our discussion today?
No, the one thing I guess I could add, you know, we're very, very excited. I mean, our company is growing rapidly. I would dare say we're one of the fastest growing companies in Ontario, if not in Canada right now. But, you know, our technology is, there's quite a buzz starting, you know, and that's
indeed.
That's the biggest thing, you know, that's the most exciting thing, because it's word of mouth. It's not, you know, it's not what I say or what we put out there in print.
And the numbers are doing the talking. And the numbers are doing the talking. Jim, we do have to go now. We're out of time. Thank you so much for being with us.